Thank you, sir. So, good evening to all present today, faculty members, members of the Family Food Bar Association, and all the participants. Welcome to the webinar hosted by Maharashtra National Law University, Mumbai, in collaboration with the Family Food Bar Association, Mumbai. So, the topic for today is on alienation and shared parenting issues, challenges, and solutions. The topic is essentially related to alienation and shared parenting. Shared parenting is the practice of both parents taking equal responsibility of the child even after ending their marriage. And parental alienation is essentially manipulation of the child by either parent to reject the other. I would request all the participants to keep their microphones and videos. Questions will be taken at the end of the session. So please drop the questions in the box. I'll pose the questions to the speaker after I speak. So in this session, we will hear from our esteemed speaker and chief guest for today, Shri Anil Malhotra. We shall begin the session with a welcome address by Dr. Anand Raut. Firstly, I would like to introduce her. Dr. Anand Raut is an assistant professor at MNLU Mumbai and holds an additional charge of head of graduate department. He is also a member of the Academic Council and Deputy Director of Center for Information Communication and Technology Law. He is the founding faculty of Maharashtra National Law University, Mumbai. I would like to invite Sir for the welcome address.
Thank you, Parth, for those kind words. I must say it's indeed an honor to welcome this August gathering, joined here virtually, though, to attend the webinar on, as what rightly Parth pointed out, alienation and shared parenting, issues, challenges, and solutions. Maharashtra National Law University, Mumbai, established under Maharashtra National Law University Act 2014, is one of the premier national law universities in India and is into its sixth year of imparting legal education. University aims for imparting advanced legal education and promote society-oriented research in legal studies for the advancement of societal life of the people in the country. One of its visions being to inculcate passion for creative and critical thinking and a commitment to the transformative solution.
I would request everyone to keep their audio off, please. Thank you.
Yes. So, what I was saying is that one of the visions of the university is to inculcate passion for creative and critical thinking and a commitment to transformative solution. With the guidance from Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Dr. Dilip Uke, Registrar Dr. Anil Variyath, and my colleagues like Dr. Karuna Malviya, MNLU Mumbai has been regularly organizing various programs and invites experts from relevant fields. And in continuation and in consonance to that, I heartily welcome Advocate Sasidharan Nair, President Family Court Bar Association, other members of Family Court Bar Association, and distinguished guest speaker of today's webinar, Sri Anil Malhotra, Advocate, High Court of Punjab and Haryana, author and legal analyst, IAFL fellow, and alumnus of prestigious the School of Oriental and African Studies, London. So with this, I heartily welcome you all. Over to you, Parth.
Thank you, sir, for those insightful words. I would now like to welcome the President of the Family Court Bar Association, Mumbai, Advocate Mr. Sasidharan Nair, to share his views and knowledge with us.
Yes. Good evening, everybody. I cannot tell it is a very pleasant situation because entire world is going through a pandemic period. Instead of a human touching and seeing together, we are sitting in a webinar and discussing, and we are keeping the hope that we will again meet, we will again touch, we will again share. very happy to be a part of MNLU, and more happy that a very learned advocate, Mr. Malhotra sir, is with us. We are not new to MNLU, because so many joint ventures we done together. So I will directly come to the subject. It's a welcome address, which I am presenting it. Of course, our Dr. Dilip Ukke is unfortunately not there. Anil Varia sir is not there. But of course, there is one Anil sir is there. That is great. So good evening, everybody. It is my privilege to address all you gathered here on online to deal with the subject, which is most related to the right of parents and right of the children. I, Shashidharan K. Nair, President FCBA, on behalf of Family Court Bar Association, welcome all you, especially respected guest speaker of today, Advocate Sri Anil Malhotra, advocate from Honorable High Court of Punjab and Haryana. Of course, Professor Dr. Dilip Ukke, Vice Chancellor MNLU, and Professor Dr. Anil Variyath, in charge registrar of MNLU, Dr. Anand Rao, Dr. Karuna Malaviya, and President, Vice President and Secretary of FCBA, Advocate Angana Pradhan and Advocate Sridha Dalvi. Whole world is going through the pandemic situation, and we are in the middle of a lockdown due to COVID-19. Break the chain and break the barriers of limitation are the two tasks before all of us. Hope that must be given us for all situations. That is simply the hope. Learn from yesterday, live for today, hope for tomorrow. The famous Albert Einstein told once about it. Dear all respected dignitaries, colleagues and friends, today we interact at this webinar with an important subject, very much related to the personal life of all of us, that is about the guardianship, custody, welfare, and upbringing of children. Our respected, resourceful person, Advocate Sri Anil Malhotra, will explain and elaborate the subject, that is alienation and shared parenting issues, challenges, and solutions. Related to above subject, the parents, lawyers, and judges always deal with two to three words, that is joint custody, shared custody, physical custody, legal custody, etc., etc. Where does a minor child go after a divorce or separation of parents? Which is a very painful question, argued in most of the matrimonial disputes without any satisfactory answer for the same. The prime point about the custody of the child, the welfare of the child, and that must be the paramount consideration of any decision making of the court. Now also, many of the parents, lawyers and judges not wholeheartedly accept the fact that child is not a private property. Child is not a private property of anybody, and child is the asset of a country and gift of the nature. It is therefore most important that the custodial parent must assure the welfare of the child at its best, which lies with them. In short, either joint custody or shared custody or parenting, it would be in the best interest and welfare of the child. A very recent judgment of Supreme Court of India, Apex Court, that is Aman Lohia versus Kiran Lohia, that is recently in March 2021 this judgment came. The court pointed out a very important point, and it is about the approach towards the custody issue. The words used are child-centric approach. I'm repeating the word, child-centric approach. It contains all the crust of the parenting concept. I'm ending my present speech with an abbreviation PAS, which is mainly and commonly used in child custody arguments in court. The full form of it as Parent Alienation Syndrome, PAS. I'm sure that Advocate Anil Malhotra will definitely enlighten us the nooks and corners of the very delicate subject of today. And with all of you, I am also eagerly waiting for your valid presentation in such a inside aspect and a total subject at its depth and importance, respected sir. Thanking all of you and assure all you that togetherness of FCBA with you all at a normal and midst of any difficult situation, I'm assuring. Thank you all for your participation and the patient hearing of my few words. With a warm regards and humble request to stay safe and take care. Sachin Nair from this end. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. That was a very informative speech, and we hope you stay well also. I would now like to briefly introduce our next speaker, Dr. Karuna Malviya, who shall be giving the presidential address. Ma'am is the director of the Center for Advanced Training in Taxation Laws and the coordinator for the Center for Women's Law and Gender Justice. Before joining MNC Mumbai, she has been the IC principal to MGM Law College, Nehrul in Navi Mumbai, and a resource person in renowned universities and colleges. Besides, she has been a coordinator for the universities of Mumbai's collaborative programs with international courts and universities, and has done exemplary work for the cause of society, especially in the area of gender sensitization and women empowerment. Her work has been appreciated by the mayor of Navi Mumbai and has received many recognitions. I would now like to give the floor to ma'am.
Thank you, Parth, for your kind words. Good evening, everyone. I, Dr. Karuna Akshay Malviya, Director for Center for Advanced Training in Taxation Laws, MNLU Mumbai, is here to address on behalf of our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Dr. Dilip Mukherjee. Sir could not join this webinar due to an urgent meeting. Maharashtra National Law University Mumbai is in collaboration with Family Court Bar Association Mumbai, has organized many programs in past and is in still collaborative terms to organize future programs in the interest of social awareness and provide experts knowledge sharing platform. The active role of Advocate Shashidharan Nair, President of FCBA, and Ms. Shraddha Dalvi, Secretary FCBA, in organizing programs on developing areas of laws in association with MNLU Mumbai is worth appreciating. This webinar on alienation and shared parenting is indeed a dynamic area to discuss with aspects of its issues, challenges, and solutions. We have our esteemed guest speaker, Advocate Anil Malhotra, who is practicing advocate, author, and legal analyst, will be highlighting on this topic. We are very much thankful to him for accepting our invitation. Parental alienation is an offshoot of hostile aggressive parenting. It causes post-traumatic stress, depression, insecurity, loneliness, pent-up anger, fear of abandonment, and lack of trust on young and impressionable minds. Parentage is not a rigid process of upbringing the child. Rather, it is a culture. Mother is a primary caregiver, but father's role in imparting love and guidance is extremely important to shape the lives of children. Parental alienation is not conducive to give upbringing of kids. However, Shared parenting can be a resource to save children from being primary victims of matrimonial dispute and custody claims. There are many practical hurdles in implementing the concept in an acute husband-wife skirmish. The Indian law generally talks about exclusive custody of children, either by father or mother, depending upon the age of children and other circumstances. The phrase, the best interest of children, is often given a restricted and partisan meaning. There is a need for mass education on the relevance of shared parenting in India. We should seriously think about the relevance of parenting plan in matrimonial litigation whenever it is necessary or possible. Such an action plan can mitigate the injuries caused to the psyche of a child who happened to be in court for no fault on their part. I congratulate all the participants on behalf of MNLU Mumbai for their participation, and I'm sure all of you will be benefited by the expertise knowledge of our guest speaker. Over to Parth.
Thank you, ma'am, for sparing out your time today from your busy schedule, and it was indeed a very insightful speech. I would now like to briefly introduce our speaker, who is our chief guest today, Mr. Anil Malhotra, who is an advocate in the Punjab and Haryana High Court. Sir completed his Bachelor in Science as well as Bachelor in Law from Punjab University in Chandigarh, and he completed his LLM from the University of London in 1985. He previously worked in many roles, including as a part-time lecturer at Faculty of Law in Punjab University and as an additional central government standing counsel in the High Court. He has also represented many private clients and has rendered substantial assistance as an amicus curiae with reported judgments on various issues of public law importance. He conducted a number of litigations on inter-country parental child removal matters and has persistently proposed, debated, and discussed the need for India to sign the Hague Convention on Interparental Child Abduction, 1980. He has also many publications on this topic, some of which are titled The Removed Child and the Law in India, that was published in 2018, and Inter-Country Parental Child Removal and the Law, that was published in 2016. I would now like to give the floor to Sir.
Thank you, Parth. Respected President Mr. Nair, Dr. Kumud Malviya, my friend, colleague, advocate Shraddha, members of the bar, officials of the Maharashtra National Law University, participants, fellow lawyers, and associates. A very good evening. It is a matter of honor for me that I have been called by this esteemed bar and the Maharashtra National Law University to speak.
Could you please switch off your mic?
I am very grateful and indebted to the Maharashtra University and the family of Mumbai for giving me this opportunity to speak on this important topic, which has acquired immense relevance and significance in as much that it is guided by judicial wisdom due to the law on the subject statutorily being very old and requiring serious amendment. Now, I wanted to share straight away with you that the matter which was mentioned by President Nair, Aman Lohia's case, was handled by me for the father in the Supreme Court. And it is there that the child-centric jurisprudence word was coined, but it has been taken up in earlier litigations in which I have proposed this suggestion that the focus in custody matters, the focus, the attention, the centric jurisprudence should be the child. The litigation concerning the child should relate to the voice of the child, the welfare of the child, the best interest of the child, and not the rights of the parties to be litigated. In this perspective, I think it is very important, before we go into the issue of alienation and parenting, that we first look at where we stand in terms of statute. Where are we in terms of the law made by Parliament on this issue is concerned. Now, as you all know, India is not having any uniform civil code, and all family law legislations applicable as personal laws to different religious communities are by virtue of codified personal laws available in separate enactments to every community. Focusing on the majority law for the Hindus, insofar the marriage law is concerned, it is the Hindu Marriage Act. For adoptions, it is the Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act of 56. And insofar guardianship and custody is concerned, it is the Hindu Minority and Guardianship Act of 1956. Now, this is an act to modify and codify, it is an act to amend and codify certain parts relating to minority and guardianship among Hindus. Now, something very important which we mostly miss is Section 2 of the Hindu Minority and Guardianship Act, I'll call it HMGA for short, is that the provisions of this act are in addition to and not in derogation of the Guardian and Wards Act of 1890. So effectively speaking, whenever we have to invoke the judicial procedure, the statutory remedy for invoking anything relating to guardianship and custody is laid down in the Guardian and Wards Act. So any petition to be filed insofar Hindus is concerned can be a conjoint petition under the HMGA read with the GWA or under the GWA alone. Now, Section 4A of the HMGA defines a guardian as a person having the care of a person, of a minor, or his property in both, and includes a natural guardian, a guardian appointed by will, or a guardian declared by the court. Now, Section 6 is the most litigated provision on the basis of which custody claims rest. And Section 6 talks of the natural guardians of a Hindu minor. And it reads that the natural guardian of a Hindu minor shall be his father, and after him the mother, in the case of a boy or an unmarried girl, provided that the custody of a minor who has not completed the age of 5 years shall ordinarily be with the mother. Now, so in broad, simple terms, the natural guardian of a minor child is the father, and after him the mother. Though in Gita Hariharan's case, it has been said that both the father and mother are equal. The word after him doesn't mean after the death of the father. Where there is a non-participating father, it can mean the mother also. So the natural guardian is the father and the mother, and the custody of a child ordinarily, of a child less than 5 years of age, shall be with the mother. So it is the custody only which is presumed to be with the mother for a child less than 5 years of age. The guardianship is not displaced. Now, the question whether the residence of the child is the residence of the mother is an issue which will be decided with the Guardian and Wards Act. And there can be no presumption drawn that wherever the mother lives, the residence of the child will be located there. But the issue of jurisdiction is coordinated by Section 9 of the Guardian and Wards Act. Now, completing the reading of the provisions of the sections of the HMGA, it is further specified in Section 13 that in the appointment or declaration of the guardian of a Hindu minor, the welfare of the child shall be in paramount consideration, and no person shall be entitled to guardianship by virtue of the provisions of this act or by any law relating to guardianship or marriage if the court is of the opinion that his or her guardianship will not be for the welfare of the minor. So I would think that sections 13 vis-a-vis welfare has to be read over and above section 6. So any prior right or preemptive right or superior right of a parent will be subject to the welfare of the child, which obviously will have to be decided by the concerned family court or the guardian court as the case may be. So now this reading brings us to the Guardian and Wards Act of 1890. Now, the Guardian and Wards Act 1890 was primarily a law made by the English, and it was a law meant to consolidate and amend the law relating to guardians among Hindus. Now, Section 4, Subsection 2 defines a guardian as a person, again, who has the care of the person, having the care of the person of a minor or his property, or both his person and property. So, it meant having care, not custody. So the word guardian is in a different connotation as far as this is concerned. Now, the important provision in Section 9 of the Guardian and Wards Act containing the issue of jurisdiction stands in 9, but before that in Section 7. Section 7 says that where the court is satisfied that it is for the welfare of the minor, that an order should be made, it can appoint a guardian for his person or property or declare a person to be such guardian. And therefore, in this case, the court may declare that an order should be made accordingly for the appointment of a guardian. Now, effectively and substantially, what happens? Whenever there is a dispute interparental on issues of matrimonial problems, the fallout and the victim is the children. So, in an attempt to secure the singular custody of the child, the father or the mother, as the case may be, invokes the jurisdiction of the family court or the guardian judge, and under the provisions of the Guardian and Wards Act, seeks exclusive custody and sole guardianship of the child by virtue of the fact that he or she has, so to say, a superior claim of his or her rights, which he wants to establish. In most litigations, the parent demonstrates his or her superior rights over the child, forgetting that the rights in the best interest of the child should be the dominating factor. So losing focus, losing sight of the best interest in the welfare of the child, the way the legislation is existing, joint custody, joint guardianship not being talked of, the child becomes a pawn in a battle warring between two spouses to secure custody, singular in nature, by virtue of these provisions. So this is the sum and substance of the provisions leading to the litigation and how it takes shape. Now, Section 9 guides the jurisdictional issue. Section 9 says that if the application is in respect of the guardianship of the person of the minor, it shall be made to the district court having jurisdiction in the place where the minor ordinarily resides. So any petition concerning the minor for his guardianship and custody filed by a parent has to be filed in a court where the minor ordinarily resides. Now, it says where the minor ordinarily resides. It does not say where the parent having custody ordinarily resides. So Section 6 of the HMGA, which we just saw, which talked of the minor's custody being with the mother less than 5 years of age, will not guide jurisdiction. The jurisdiction will be guided by where the minor ordinarily resides. Various interpretations by various different high courts have explained where the minor ordinarily resides to mean where the minor habitually and permanently resides, and where the minor has been brought up or is a resident of, or is in a country different than India. So it does not mean the place where the minor is found or is located on the date the petition for guardianship is filed, or in a place where the minor is brought by one of the parents, or where the minor is detained temporarily for the purpose of filing of the petition. Then the form of the application of a guardianship petition is in Section 10. And Section 12 talks of power of interlocutory orders to be made by the court for the interim arrangements of the minor. So for any temporary custody order for protection of the minor and for its welfare, the court can pass interim orders under section 12. And for doing so, and also to decide the matter finally, section 17 says that the matters to be considered in appointing a guardian will be what appears to be the welfare of the minor. So in conducting or considering the what will be the welfare of the minor, the court will have regard to the age, religion, character, capacity, kin, who is the kin, any existing or previous relations, and so on and so forth. Further, it says that if the minor is old enough to form an intelligent preference, the court will consider any such preference. Section 19 says that in the unless and until the mother or the father is declared unfit, they will not be excluded from being guardians of the child. So this is broadly what the substantive and real part of the Guardian and Wards Act says about this. Now, there is another provision in the Hindu Adoption and Maintenance Act which defines a guardian, and the definition is on the similar lines. The provision is contained in section 9, subsection 5(1)(a). It says guardian means the person having the care of the person of the child or both his person and property, and includes a guardian appointed by the will or a guardian declared by the court. And court here means, in this act, the city civil court, not the family court for its purposes. So this is insofar these provisions are concerned. Now, wherever there is a family court, we have to be guided by the Family Courts Act 1984, and the jurisdictional aspect is contained in section 7 of the Family Courts Act. So in the Family Courts Act, it is said that the family court shall have jurisdiction exercisable, which was exercised by a district court. So in jurisdictions like Delhi, Bombay, Calcutta, wherever the High Court had jurisdiction, it would mean the High Court also. So the jurisdiction is taken away, except in these bigger places where there is a presidency law which confers jurisdiction on the family court. The suits and proceedings referred to in the explanation talk of the various nature of matters. Insofar guardianship and custody is concerned, any suit or proceeding in relation to the guardianship of the person, of the custody or access of the minor, is essentially what will go to a family court. Now, just to fill you in with some very important provisions on the Family Courts Act. First of all, there is the duty of the family court to make a settlement. That is under section 9. It says that it will be predominant or an endeavor that the family court should first try to settle the matter. Then the procedure generally in section 10, CPC is applicable, but section 10, subsection 3 also says that nothing shall prevent a family court from laying down its own procedure with a view to arrive at a settlement in respect of any subject matter or to come at the truth of the facts alleged by one party or denied by the other. So, substantively, as was held in Aman Lohia's case, once the form and substance of the petition filed is satisfied, the content is according to the statute. Thereafter, the procedure is in the hands of the family court to take over and decide as to how best the litigation is to be conducted. And for this purposes, the court under section 14 of the Family Courts Act is free and not bound by the shackles of the law of evidence, because insofar that is concerned, it says that the family court may receive evidence, in evidence any report, statement, document, information or matter which in its opinion will assist with it to deal with it effective, to deal effectively any dispute whether or not the same would be otherwise relevant or admissible under the Indian Evidence Act. So the court can record oral evidence, the court can take evidence of formal affidavit on character, the court can take any document even though it is inadmissible under the law of evidence and come to the substance of the matter. So this is as far as the Family Courts Act is concerned. Now, one aspect which sometimes comes into issue is a custody order obtained under the Protection of Women from Domestic Violence Act 2005. Now, in an application before a magistrate, unlike an application before a district court or a family court for deciding custody, custody orders can also be obtained as an interim measure under Section 21 of the Domestic Violence Act, because it says in here that notwithstanding anything contained in any other law for the timing in force, a magistrate may, on the hearing of an application for protection, may grant temporary custody of any child or children to the grieved person or person making an application on his behalf, and make arrangements for the visit of the such child by the respondent. Now, provided that the magistrate is of the opinion that any visit to the respondent may be harmful, the magistrate shall refuse to allow such visit. Now, this is a very important provision insofar as interim powers are concerned. So this can be a stopgap arrangement in the interim, but it cannot be and will not be a substitute for a effective resolution of the dispute under the Guardian and Wards Act or the Family Courts Act for the custody to be decided substantively as a provision of law. So this is made clear when in Section 26 of the Domestic Violence Act, it is said that any relief which is obtained under Section 21 is one of them, may also be sought in any legal proceeding before a civil court, family court, or a criminal court affecting the aggrieved person and the respondent, whether such proceeding was initiated before or after the commencement of this act. So any interim order under the DV Act cannot assume any finality, because the substantive litigation has to be arrived at under the provisions of the Guardian and Wards Act. You also have the issues relating to custody of children being decided under Section 26 of the Hindu Marriage Act in a divorce petition. Now, in such a situation, the jurisdiction is guided by where the divorce petition is filed. So that is a different provision which comes in as an ancillary relief in a matter concerning divorce between parties. Insofar the HMGA and the GWA are concerned, they are substantive provisions to decide custody without getting into the issue of the dispute between the parties and deciding exclusively on the rights of the child. Now, another very important input which has unfortunately escaped the notice of family courts and pleaders who appear in to argue these litigations is the best interest of the child defined in Section 2, subsection 9 of the Juvenile Justice Care and Protection of Children Act 2015. Now, at the outset, I wish to explain very briefly how the amendments in this provision or this enactment came about. Now, India signed the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child in 1992. And consequentially, India was duty-bound to incorporate within its law a number of beneficial provisions relating to children and the rights of children being implemented, right of a child to a name, a nationality, a home, parents not to be separated from his parents, and so on and so forth. So the JJ Act of 1986 was amended in 2000. Then the major amendments took place in 2015. The JJ Act talks of children in need of care and protection. It talks of juveniles in conflict with law. And it talks of rehabilitation and social integration vis-a-vis the process of adoption is concerned. Now, if you look at the very broad compass of the definition of children in need of care and protection, it will include children who are at risk by virtue of interparental child removal and who are in the custody of one parent, depriving the other custody of the child to the other parent, or preventing him from taking any effective decision vis-a-vis the control, custody, and the welfare of the child is concerned. So in this backdrop, the Delhi High Court has cleared the air and has started accepting that the definition of the best interest of the child in the JJ Act has to come in a child-centered jurisprudence, in child custody litigations, in between parents as well. So for the benefit of all, let us read what section 2 subsection 9 reads in the best interest of the child. It says best interest of the child means the basis for any decision taken regarding the child to ensure fulfillment of his basic rights and needs, identity, social well-being, and physical, emotional, and intellectual development. And child means a person who has not completed 18 years of age. Now, the word guardian is also defined in section 231 of the JJ Act, and it says, guardian in relation to a child means a natural guardian or any other person having, in the opinion of the committee, that is a child welfare committee, or as the case may be the board, that is the juvenile justice board, the actual charge of the child and recognized by the committee of the board as a guardian in the course of the proceedings. So effectively, guardian means a natural guardian or a guardian who is the child welfare committee or the JJ board, which is in the case of orphan, abandoned, surrendered children or delinquent children. Now, clearly, if you look at the definition of the best interest of the child, one would think that if we were to look at the definition of the best interest of the child, which has escaped tension of interpretation due to not being pleaded or not being agitated, the concept of custody has always swung in Indian jurisprudence to decide the custody of the child in a singular fashion. Now, because we have dwelt on issues like custody, meaning singular custody, guardianship, meaning guardianship in preference to one person, whereby one parent goes to court and says, I want to be the sole guardian, I want to be the sole custodian. So the shift, jurisprudential shift, has been always in an attempt by the courts to decide superior claims of the father or the mother, ignoring the child or not really substantially looking at the best interest in the welfare of the child. And there could not have been a better definition as given in section 2, subsection 9 of the JJ Act. Now, this definition is a collection of a large number of provisions of the UNCRC, which is an international convention looking at the best interests of the children, and a wholesome composite and a complete welfare development of the child cannot be promoted unless there is a mother and a father. How this is arrived at, how this is to be achieved, is something we will now see as we go along. Now, because we were so outmoded and so singular in our concept of looking at what is on, the Law Commission in report number 257 looked at reforms in
Everybody be there. Sir will be back. I think some technical problems. Be on the line. He will be back.
So the face of the child custody arrangements in a number of countries over the globe was looked at. A research paper, a consultation paper was evolved. And the conclusion was that the law on custody in India has evolved to a point where it is now appropriate to initiate a discussion of shared parenting. So this is effectively where the seed of shared parenting was sown, and it developed, and they received a number of responses on the basis of which they coined a thought process to proceed further and the entire stereotyping of gender-based stereotypes that a girl child should be raised by the mother and the boy child is to be raised with the father were said to be outdated. They felt that valuable contributions are made by both parents, irrespective of gender issues. So with this backdrop, the consultation paper, the chairman formed a subcommittee, had a series of meetings with practitioners, academics, legal experts, and involved a large number of people. And the concept of joint custody, so to say, started to be coined. So they looked at the concept of joint custody first to come to a conclusion as to what was best suited for India. Now, when they examined the concept of joint custody, they looked at a definition which came from the state of Virginia and the US. Now, joint custody in that jurisdiction meant joint legal custody where both parents retain joint responsibility for the care and control of the child and joint authority to make decisions concerning the child, even though the child's primary residence may be with one parent. Joint physical custody was where both parents share physical and custodial care of the child, or any combination of joint legal and joint physical custody where the court deems to be in the best interest of the child. So this was one proposition, but it also looked at a definition given by a Child Rights Foundation, a Mumbai-based NGO, which said the child may reside alternatively 1 week with the custodial parent and 1 week with the non-custodial parent, and that both custodial and non-custodial parents will share joint responsibility for decisions involving long-term care, welfare, and development of the child. Now, the reasons which the Law Commission found for adopting joint custody was economic and societal transformation, which saw families becoming more complex and leading to dissolution. Then judicial attitude towards custody considerably changing. It took into opinion various views that there were battles and biologically neither the mother nor the father was equipped to handle the child. Thirdly, the concept of shared custody was already engaging the courts. And the conclusion drawn by the Law Commission was that they were not in favor of a law placing a presumption in favor of joint custody. So the Law Commission was of the view that shared and equal guardianship for both parents would be a better option. And they left the issue of custody to be decided by the guardian judge, but advocated shared and equal guardianship as a better proposition in their perspective. Now, with this backdrop, the Law Commission also looked at considerations for deciding child custody cases. They looked at factors of the best interest of the child, preference of the child, access to the child by parents, grandparents, mediation, relocation, decision making. And now one of the issues they looked at was a parenting plan. Now, in this context, they said that a number of jurisdictions require divorcing parents to submit a shared parenting plan to the court. It said the plan must address areas including education, health, religion, procedures for resolving disputes and duties, best periods of time to visit each other or the child to reside, holidays, vacations, procedure to by which such periods of time will be determined. Some jurisdictions provide additional guidance regarding communication between custodial and non-custodial parents, transportation to other parents' residence, what to do if a parent wishes to relocate, how to change schedule parenting time, and exchanging information about the child. Now, the parenting plan itself is not a legal document, and it acquires teeth only by an order of the court. So it is only where and when a court accepts a parenting plan that it acquires a legal significance, because as of now, there is no judicial support to the concept of a parenting plan. Now, a lot of what the Law Commission said made a lot of sense. Now, the Law Commission did not leave it at that. The Law Commission, in a very sensible manner, suggested that the Hindu Minority and Guardianship Act and the Guardian and Wards Act be amended. And they suggested, insofar as Section 6 of the HMGA was concerned, they suggested that the substitution shall take place by saying that in the case of a boy or an unmarried girl, the mother and the custody, the mother and the father shall be natural guardians. And they suggested an explanation too. It said, for the purposes of Clause A, unless joint custody is granted by the court under chapter so-and-so, the custody of a minor who has not completed 5 years of age shall ordinarily be with the mother. So they looked at joint custody being granted by the court. So they left it to the court to decide to grant joint custody, failing which the custody would go to the mother under the age of 5 years. This is an amendment suggested. It never saw the light of the day for different reasons. Likewise, in the Guardian and Wards Act, they suggested welfare principle it be added in Section 17. Now, the most important suggestions which the Law Commission made for amendment were insertion of a new chapter, Chapter 2A, to be inserted after the principal act, that is the Guardian and Wards Act. Now, Chapter 2A was to talk of custody, child support, and visitation. So, what were the objectives of this chapter? It says, objectives are ensuring the child has the best of both parents, ensuring the child receives adequate, proper parenting, ensuring that the parent fulfills their duties and meets their responsibilities, giving due consideration to the changing emotional intellectual developments, encouraging both parents to maintain a close relationship, recognizing that the child has a right to know and to be cared by both the parents, regardless of whether the parents are married, separated or unmarried, protecting the child from psychological harm. So these were very important objectives which saw the child as a person, the child as an individual, the child as a very important unit about whom the dispute was all about. And it defined in Section 19C joint custody as sharing physical custody of the child, which may be shared equally in proportion as the court may determine for the welfare of the child. Equally share the joint responsibility for the care of the child and joint authority to take decisions. Then sole custody meant where one parent retains physical custody responsibility for the care and control, subject to the powers of the court to grant visitation to the other parent. So this was a participatory role of both parents with visitation to one. But joint custody was joint of everything. Then for award of custody, Section 90D proposed that in proceeding to which the chapter applies, court may order joint custody or sole custody depending on the welfare of the child. What would be the welfare? The court may take different factors and pass orders. And then it talked of mediation. Now the court, in a very wisdom fashion, suggested that in the Principal Act, there should be a schedule at the end. And in the schedule, they recommended that it contain what it proposed were guidelines for custody, child support, and visitation arrangements. So what was the Law Commission trying to do? The Law Commission was actually trying to put into the statute, which the statute ought to contain, and which, if was there in the statute, would be enabling the family court or law practitioners to plead for joint parenting, joint custody, and shared arrangements by virtue of a statutory law, which would be a statutory duty and not an optional obligation to be considered in the discretion of the court. So what it suggested in the schedule was, what are the factors to be considered for grant of joint custody? First, for making an order of joint custody, the court shall have regard to whether the parents will be able to cooperate and agree, whether the parents are willing to facilitate and encourage a close and continuing relationship with the child, whether parents are willing to able to jointly design and implement a day-to-day care plan, the maturity, lifestyle, and background, including culture and traditions of the child and the parents, the extent to which the parent has fulfilled such responsibilities, extent to which parents are able to find a reasonable way of working together, extent to which the parents with higher income is willing to support the similar standards of living separately, child's existing relationship with each other, siblings and other parents, consideration to important relationships, including other peer members and extended family members. Next, any family violence concerning the child, member of the child's family, whether the child is capable of forming an intelligible preference, and any other circumstance. So these were factors which were very relevant, which could be a roadmap for the family court to keep in mind, and with the judicial training of the mind of the family court, which is vested with that discretion, it would have a charter to take over and perhaps carve a plan effectively for making a parenting plan. So then the issues whether on the determining the preference of the child were also spelt out, then access to the records of the child, then grandparenting time, then mediation, then relocation, then decision making, then came parenting plan and part 8. So what were the objectives of a parenting plan? The objectives of a parenting plan are to minimize the child's exposure to harmful parental conflict and to encourage parents to mutually agree on the division of responsibilities of the child's upbringing through agreements in parenting plan rather than relying on the court intervention. So in designing a parenting plan, parents must ensure that it is for the welfare of the child that its day-to-day needs are met, any special needs are met, childs get to spend sufficient time with each parent and to get to know each parent as far as possible, minimal disruption of the child's education, daily routine and association with family and friends, transition from one parental home to another is effectively and safely carried out. Then, a parenting plan may deal with one or more of the following, namely, parent or parents with whom the child is to live, the time the child is to spend with the other parent, allocation of parental responsibility of the child, manner in which the parents have to consult each other regarding responsibilities, communication of the child with other persons, maintenance of the child, process to be used for resolving disputes about the operation of the plan, process to be taken for changing the plan to account for changing needs of the child, any other aspects of the welfare of the child. Then the parenting plan must be voluntarily and knowingly arrived at by each parent. Then the court shall not ordinarily interfere with the division of responsibility between the parents reflecting in the parent plans unless they are ex facie inequitable. Then all the initial parenting plan, if the initial parenting plan does not contain or cover certain issues, parents may approach the court to modify the decisions to take or address new subjects of decision making. Then visitation. Now, clearly, this was a roadmap for the child and a charter to be carved out, but it also gave liberty that this is never going to assume finality. Now, the courts have always said child rights are never final. They evolve, they change, they can be modified, they confer no finality. There is no res judicata, there is no estoppel on child rights. You can agitate, re-agitate. A child is a human being. A child is not a piece of property owned by a parent, possessed by a parent, or controlled by a parent. Now, it is in this context that, unfortunately, when this twist takes place of a child being maneuvered, controlled, manipulated, or monopolized by a parent, sadly and unfortunately, that what comes about is parental alienation syndrome. Now, this is a concept which is not defined in any law. It is a psychological disorder which has found explanation in texts relating to child jurisprudence, but it has been brilliantly expounded by Honorable Justice A.K. Sikri in the judgment of Vivek Singh versus Romani Singh, 2017, 3 SCC 231. Now, paras 12, 13, and 20 deal with the concept of the welfare of the child. And it says that the best interest of the child has to be placed at the vanguard of all family, custody disputes according to the optimal growth and development of the child, with primacy over other considerations. The child is often left to grapple with the breakdown of an adult institution. While parents aim to ensure that the child is least affected by the outcome, inevitability and uncertainty which follows is the child's growth lingers on till the new routine sinks. The effect of separation of spouses on children psychologically, emotionally, and even to some extent physically spans from negligible to serious and could be noticeably critical. It could also affect effects which are transitory to long-lasting, having significant repercussions, negative in the advancement of the child. While these effects do not apply to every child of a separated or divorced couple, nor has any child experienced all these effects, the deleterious risks of maladjustment remains the objective of the parents to evade the court's intents to circumvent. The rights of the child are also based on individual dignity. Now, the welfare principle is also based on public interest, and it is here that the Supreme Court for the first time said the rightful place of the child in the sizable fabric has been recognized in many international covenants which have been adopted in this country as well. Child-centric human rights jurisprudence that has been evolved over a period of time is founded on the principle that public good demands proper growth of the child, who is the future of the nation. So it is for the first time that the Supreme Court really spoke of concentrating and focusing on the child by using the concept of a child-centric jurisprudence. Now, as we go further in this judgment, in paragraph number 18, the Supreme Court talked of the alienation. It says, the court cannot turn a blind eye to the fact that there have been strong feelings of bitterness, betrayal, anger and distress between the appellant and the respondent, though they were talking about the case, where each party feels that they are right in many of their views and issues which led to their separation. The intensity of the negative feeling of the appellant towards the respondent would have obvious effect on the child, who has remained in the company of her father to the exclusion of the mother. The possibility of the appellant's effort to get the child to give up her own positive perceptions of the other parent, i.e. the mother, and change her to agree with the appellant's viewpoint cannot be ruled out, thereby diminishing the affection of the child towards the mother. Obviously, the appellant during all this period would have not said anything about the positive traits of the mother. Even the matrimonial dispute between the parents would have been understood by the child as perceived by the parties. Psychologists term it as parental alienation syndrome. So this is for the first time that the Supreme Court gave a color to this concept by saying that parental alienation syndrome has at least two psychological destructive effects. First, it puts the child squarely in the middle of a context of loyalty, a contest which cannot possibly be won. The child is asked to choose who is the preferred parent. No matter whatever is the choice of the child is very likely to end up feeling painfully guilty and confused. This is because in the overwhelming majority of cases, what the child wants and needs is to continue a relationship with each parent as independently as possible from their own conflicts. Secondly, the child is required to make a shift in assessing the reality. One parent is presented as being totally to blame for all problems as someone who is devoid of any positive characteristics. Both of these assertions represent one parent's distortion of reality. Now, these are very meaningful words, and they have been described as quoted in the judgment by Dr. Richard Gardner in Recent Developments of Child Custody Litigation, published in the Academy Forum by the American Academy of Psychoanalysis. So it is in this presumption that the court refused to decide the issue of custody, felt that the mother ought to have quality time with the child because the child had been too long with the father, and the court felt that unless this was done, they cannot decide on the issue of custody. Now, the court started looking at responsibility, duty, and the Law Commission's recommendation of looking at joint responsibility in talking of shared parenting, doing away with the outmoded concept of singular custody and singular guardianship, were in tandem with these thoughts. Now, the concept of shared parenting has evolved in the judgment of Tushar Vishnu Ubale, a judgment of the Bombay High Court by Justice Mrudula Bhatkar, AIR 2016, Bombay 88. Now, in paragraph 15, after discussing the judgment of the Law Commission, the High Court says, for spouses who are shying away from each other and fighting over the child, the word custody connotes inherent crisis of sharing. To get company, love, and affection of both parents means a shared custody. A child wants to share his joys, sorrows, failures, successes with each parent. Such association is required for healthy upbringing of the child. A father and mother must have responses towards the child sharing, which is also necessary. The child must get a sense of belonging, of social security, that he is not coming from a broken family, and should not develop self-pity. The child may become a center of curiosity, comments, staring, sympathy of classmates, friends. Peer pressure and impact is impressionable on the mind of the child. Therefore, shared custody may be an option open for the court to offer parents and make them aware of the child's needs and the child's rights. Now, Law Commission's report of shared parenting was cited, and the court went on to say that one of the tests towards a healthy and happy mind of the child is whether the child has love, affection, and equal respect towards the non-custodial parent or not. Now, the court did notice that there is no statute granting any legal right upon any parent to have the child's custody in preference to or overriding the other. So the court felt that the jurisprudence on the subject is taking into the consideration the welfare of the child. Now, in most cases, the court said egos and incompatibility were reasons of fighting of the child. The court said, you may be a bad husband, you may be a bad wife, but you may be a good father. And it is in this context that the court cited the concept which Justice Roshan Dalvi cited in her lectures, saying, what does family mean? F for father, A for and, M for mother, I for I, and L for love, you. So family in effect meant father and mother, I love you. Now, this was such a meaningful expression to such a simple word, and it carried such a long import that we, though looking at the word, actually miss the content of the word. So the court said, parenting plan is a mutual agreement of custody and access, which is an outcome of matured parenting. The idea of joint parenting is a rule, and single parenting is an exception. Now, this is a very important description. So, shared parenting should be the rule, and single parenting should be an exception. There may be a single mother or a single father left due to a blow of destiny when the child has no option. However, when both parents are available, their association with the child cannot be artificially denied due to rights of hatred and vindictive approach of parents. But the court said this is not mandatory, and it is up to the court to adopt a parenting plan and to invite a parenting plan. So the court, in a way, left it discretionary, which I think perhaps was not a good idea. It ought to have been made mandatory and not left discretionary. But the court did so, saying that there is no legislative provision which supports such an ideology. So the court said, to buttress the word parenting plan and not custody plan, custody, they said, is a narrow term. So physical handling of the child, 50% to one parent, other 50% to the other parent. The parenting plan must take into account parental responsibility as opposed to parental rights, which are not statutorily granted. Now, this is a very important shift of jurisprudence, talking of responsibility. So when you talk of shared parenting, you take 50% responsibility. You don't take 50% rights. You have a share of 50% duty towards the child. You have a 50% duty towards the responsibility towards the child. You don't possess 50% of the child as a piece of furniture. You look at the care, love, affection, bonding, upbringing, medical care, and a large number of duties as a parent. So the court cited what is welfare, and then the court talked of how the court thought best to evolve a plan. And now I found this judgment very meaningful. But then there is another very recent judgment, a division bench judgment of the Karnataka High Court in Savita Sitaraman versus Rajiv Vijayasarthi Ratnam. This is 2020. AIR Karnataka 372. Now, this is a decision of 11th of September 2020. Now, in para 9, this judgment looks at extensively the Law Commission report, and the court in para 9 says one of the ways to resolve the conundrum is by the emerging concept of shared parenting. It says in overseas jurisdictions, the concept of shared parenting has been in vogue and prevalent, but not so well entrenched in India, and has been ordered only in a few handful of cases. It is necessary to remind ourselves that a child requires both parents, the mother and the father, in joint upbringing of the child, which would have a holistic impact on the overall growth of the child. This is because both parents have a joint responsibility in bringing up their children, as each parent would contribute in a unique way to the mental, physical, and emotional / psychological development of the child. Hence, whenever there is separation between the parents, shared parenting would mean joint responsibility to continue till such arrangements are put in place. Further, in this context, it is necessary to understand two terminologies, namely joint physical custody and joint legal custody. Joint legal custody means both parents have equal rights and responsibilities towards the child, education, upbringing. Whereas joint physical custody means both parents would share physical custody by spending equal time. Then the court looks at various issues and talks of a shared parenting plan. And it quotes a previous judgment of the Madras High Court. It talks of giving away archaic concepts of custody and guardianship, and talks of joint parenting. Then it looks at the United Nations Convention on the Rights of the Child. It looks at Australian, Dutch, South African, and then Indian law. It looks at the Law Commission report. It talks of the parenting plan provisions. And then it looks at the provisions of the Guardian and Wards Act. And ultimately, in para 23, the court says, we have referred to the principle of shared parenting, which is defined to include shared parenting as well as shared parenting responsibilities in the day-to-day upbringing and welfare of the child, which has evolved over two decades in the context of custody of children. The Supreme Court, in a catena of decisions, has held that in dealing with the custody of the minor, the court has a special responsibility, and it is the duty of the court to consider the welfare of the minor and to protect the minor's interests. Over a period of time, the concepts of custody and visitation have transformed themselves into responsibility of parents towards children. So this is the shift of thought. This is the child-centric jurisprudence talking of the responsibilities to the child, not the rights of the parents. A central theme of this transformation is the emphasis of parental responsibility, which requires that the child should be treated as an individual, having his or her own capabilities and limitations, as well as independent opinions. A child is not an appendage of his or her parents. The focus must be, the attention must be on the child. So then the court has devised a plan in which, in this particular case, it looked at on how shared parenting was to come. Now, another judgment of the Delhi High Court, which looked at shared parenting, was in a case which was conducted by me. This was in the case of JK versus NS. Now, in this case also, the court said that, now this was a matter which evolved from the family court to the High Court and then to the Supreme Court. Now, it says, now it's a very important way in which the court describes the, this is a reported judgment, 2019 SCC Online, Delhi 9085, JK versus NS, decided on 1st of July 2019, and it was upheld by the Supreme Court. It says, while we have no doubts in our mind that the mother is a primary caregiver, but we cannot shut our eyes to the fact that even the father can contribute a lot to the upbringing of a child, and in fact, love, affection, guidance, and moral support of a father is extremely important in the shaping of the life of the children. Thus, the requirement of the respondent in the lives of the children, in our view, is not more equally important for the holistic growth of the child. Paramount consideration being the crucial factor, we hold that the welfare of the child lies with both the parents in a shared parenting. And therefore, the court said, we hold that the paramount welfare of the children would lie in shared parenting in the United States of America for the reasons enumerated by above. No infirmity in the judgment of the family court. Permanent and sole custody of the children cannot be given to the appellant. So this is a clear indication that in a matter relating to the custody of children, we are not looking at who is a better right holder. I would put it in a different way. I think what the court is looking at is who is a better duty holder. So the focus, the emphasis of a parent in a custody case should be not what are his better rights, not why he is better suited by virtue of his superior claims as a husband or wife. He has to prove how he is a better parent. How can he evolve his duties more effectively? But rising above that, more than that, I think what we need to do, or what we need to shift to, maybe through guidance of the Supreme Court by laying down law under 141 as practice directions, like Vishakha, we need a substantial legislation. Till Parliament evolves a law, we need a view of the Supreme Court. I did try in some matters in Supreme Court to ask the court to lay down some guidelines on shared parenting, but we have not been successful. But it is not far that family courts can make a effort. And in this process, I think when we look at the mediation, or when we look at counseling, we should make it restricted and time bound. No parent should be allowed unguided, unending time for mediation or conciliation. It should be made time bound to 60 days. And in this period of 60 days, parties should attempt that children-related issues like maintenance and access to children should be mutually closed during counseling. And if this cannot be done, the matter should be referred to the court immediately so that things like parental alienation do not seep in. And also, for having the voice of the child, we have seen that in the Family Courts Act, there is a provision that the court can take assistance of counselors, but in section 12, it is said, in every suit or proceeding, it shall be open to a family court to secure the services of a medical expert, including a person of professional engagement in promoting the welfare of the child, if it thinks it is necessary for the purposes in discharging its duties. Now, in right to legal representation under section 13, it says, the provision further says that provided that the family court may, wherever it considers it necessary in the interest of justice, seek the assistance of a legal expert as an amicus curiae. Now, this is a very important provision, which is finding an expression in Mumbai. I've seen some orders where there is a child independent lawyer who is the same as a amicus. Now, he will arrange for necessary evidence, expert evidence. He may act as a catalyst between the child and the parents, facilitating a settlement. He may give a frank opinion to the court about the health, the mental health, the academic and other activities of the child. And the court may even ask him to examine issues of parental alienation, or he can seek the evidence, help of a medical expert. And in doing so, the child independent lawyer or amicus, who's an independent person who is not appearing for either side, may examine, meet with the child, talk to the child's parents, talk to school authorities, talk to medical, psychological or psychiatric experts. He may question witnesses at the final end of the and other persons. He may arrange for a family report from a family consultant. So this is what all a child rights lawyer can do. And very recently, in the matter of Peri Kansagra, the Supreme Court has held that any report of a mediator or a person assisting the court has to be made available to the court and to the parties. And there is no non-disclosure, or there is no reason why such a report can be kept back from authority, which has to decide the issues of the rights of the child. So this is something very important, which are some inputs which I think need to be looked into and stressed in this perspective. So the bottom line is, we have to get rid of the concept of singular custody, singular guardianship, and we have to evolve a child-centric jurisprudence looking at parental duties. We have to shelve the cloak of parental rights. We have to come clean of our responsibilities. We should not view the child as a trophy to be won in a battle or to be used as a pawn for settling ego disputes in litigation, or to sort out egos. But to treat the child as a person, to treat the child as a human being, to treat the child as a person who requires development. And in that perspective, look at the definition of the best interest of the child given in the Juvenile Justice Act, which is borrowed from the provisions of the CRC. And in this process, I think lawyers assisting the courts, and I will request my colleagues in the family court bar to look at these new principles, plead them, preach them in whatever way you can. Let the family court take a decision. They will evolve law. A decision will be made, right or wrong, it will be tested. And then ultimately, maybe in one matter or the other, the Supreme Court will lay down guidelines. That is how the child-centric jurisprudence is evolving. And this is how in Lahari Sakhamuri, the Supreme Court said that the definition of the best interest of the child does not mean preference of any parent to the custody of the child, regardless of age. So the maternal preference for a child under 5 years of age was watered down in Lahari Sakhamuri, looking at the best interest of the definition of the child. Now, this was a major shift in thought. So going forward with this and looking at parental alienation syndrome very seriously, we need to look at the bigger picture. We need to be assisting the court in an effective way and assisting the court more effectively. We should not permit allegations, say under POCSO, say under cruelty to the child, say under causing harm to the child or domestic violence, as a means for avoiding sharing the child with the other parent. Parents have to realize that the child grows best with both of them, No singular parent can be a father and a mother. You can have a mothering father. You can have a father mothering. So the roles may be reversed, but the inputs of the father and the mother join to make a complete child. So this is broadly what all I have to say. With this thought process, I now leave the floor to as many questions or as many viewpoints anybody may have. And you can ask your question directly or through our coordinator, whatever is the more permissible in the organizers have organized.
Thank you, sir, today, firstly, for taking out your valuable time for this session. And that was a very informative speech. The mode of question would be the questions that are already asked. I have noted them down and shall be asking those questions one by one and telling who asked them.
Okay, sure. Go on.
Yes, sir. I'll tell the first question, which is from Sameer Goyal. Looking into the interest of the child, as we have several years delay in ongoing courts and decisions take years to come, in the meanwhile, a parent totally loses contact with the child and roots are broken up. Child will never even talk to the alienated spouse. So courts say roots are now made, so changes will not be in the interest of the child. How can this issue be tackled?
See, I personally feel that you should not wait for a conventional procedure of the court to be taken over, and you should not wait unduly for a delay. Now, Section 12 of the Guardian and Wards Act clearly permits the court to take a decision on the interim custody of the child. So you should move an application, whether you are a respondent or not. Of course, you would be a respondent where you have been deprived the custody of the child, and you should ask the court to take a call on visitation rights. Now, in the application, you must mention how and why visitation has been deprived or declined to you. If physical contact is not possible, you should ask for VC, you should ask for telephonic contact or email contact or whatever contact is possible. And if you think that the family court is delaying the matter, you can always go in a revision petition to the High Court, asking the court to take a decision, or asking the High, directing the family court to take a decision in a short span of time. Now, sometimes it becomes very averse. And I have also known people who have gone in a writ of habeas corpus simply to impress upon to the High Court that I am not getting any access at all. I may be granted access through this writ of habeas corpus, or some meaningful way should be provided to me till the matter is settled. So I think rather than keeping quiet and waiting for the court to follow its procedure, you should motion the court, petition the court, and insist on a hearing, or asking the court to devise a plan by which custody and access be made available to you. And in case you are paying maintenance, you should ask the court that the maintenance be held back till a quid pro quo, that is, access of visitation is provided to you. I think you just have to be vigilant. If you are not represented by a counsel, family court permits you to appear in person and agitate your claim. Whether you can do it online or you can do it in physically in the current times to come is another question. But I think you have to be vigilant of your own rights, and you have to push your rights if you want relief. That is the sum and substance. Next question.
Thank you, sir. I'll move on to the next question, which is from Siddhant. What steps have the Family Court Bar Association taken to stop parent alienation?
See, this is something Mr. Sashidev will answer, but I think a composite answer would be to expedite hearing in the matters, to request the court to take a call on interim custody issues primarily as a matter of priority, to request co-counsel to perhaps look at joint efforts, or even requesting mediators or conciliators to put a proposal to their respective parties in a case to come up something by mutual agreement. After all, a child is a child to both parents. He's not an enemy of either. So why should a parent have hesitation in providing access to custody if there is a meaningful dialogue? I think counseling here is very important. So the family court bar could actually play an active role in requesting the court to have an effective mediation process. But it should be time bound. So this is something the family court bar can take up collectively with the court to put it in an effective manner. This is a broad suggestion that I can give.
Sir, I will add please. About Family Court Bar Association Mumbai.
Please do.
We got a two-tier concept. We got counseling as well as mediation.
Yes.
And the mediation is very specific, up to 60 days to the result to come.
Yes.
And I am borrowing the word which you used.
Yes,
that
sir.
Is that the person who is handling the matter, either in person or the lawyer, they should be vigilant in the case of the maintenance and the custody. That is the only solution.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, sir. I'll move on to the next question.
Yes,
Sarvana A. So the question is, under which section joint custody and shared parenting is maintainable under the Guardians and Wards Act 1890?
You see, as I just explained, the concept of shared parenting, joint parenting, co-parenting has not found statutory recognition. The Guardian and Wards Act is of 1890. It is a 130-year-old legislation. We have not changed it. We have not amended it. The amendments of shared parenting, joint custody, etc., were proposed by the Law Commission in 2015. But have no amendments made effectively. So there is no provision for shared parenting, custody. All what is talked about is custody and guardianship. And this is a single swing, not joint. So there is no joint custody definition under any statute as of now. It is all in the air. And it is the court which is evolving these concepts with the Law Commission assistance. Otherwise, there is nothing in the statute.
Okay, so I'll move on to the next question, which is from Balaji. Family court cannot enforce its own custody on the wife. So how can basically the family court educate about its own rights?
See, the family court can effectively enforce its orders. It can, if there is a violating parent, it can, if the parent is receiving maintenance, pull back the maintenance. If a parent is not complying, the court can impose costs. The court can even issue notices for contempt. The court has powers of enforcement. The court has powers of enforcing its orders. It is just that the court has to be informed. The court has to be made privy to what has happened. And I think the best way to do this is not verbally. If there is a violation, if there is a negligence of performance by a party, make an application, make a miscellaneous application, explain to the court what has happened, and ask the court to take penal measures of imposing costs, of putting the party to not being paid maintenance, or asking the court to even shift the custody to the other parent. You see, you have to suggest to the court to take extreme measures. So ask the court that the custody should be taken away from the custodial parent and given to the non-custodial parent simply because the custodial parent is refusing to provide access. So you have to plead your own case. You have to agitate your own grievance if you want the court to help you. If you want the court to help you, you have to help yourself. If you are able to convince the court about what you want, you will get an effective relief. So that is in sum and substance. You have to arm the court. You have to enable the court to help you. So I guess the remedy is with you, not with the court. How best you put it across is how best you will get the relief. Next question, Parth.
Okay, sir. Thank you for that. I'll move on to the next question. which is from Samir Goel. So we have a concept of maintenance from date of application. So why is that not made in case of child's custody and access? Why is the 60 days timeline on maintenance cases, but not on child custody cases?
You see, there is no rule as such of 60 and 90 days. Now, if you look at Section 12 of the Family of the Guardian and Wards Act, it talks of power of court to make interlocutory orders for protection of minor and intended protection of personal property. So 12 reads, the court may direct any person having custody of the minor to produce him or cause him to be produced and make such an order for temporary custody and protection as it thinks proper. Now, there is no timeline fixed for 60 days or 90 days for custody. The court can take a call immediately. It is up to you. You can say, let the order of maintenance be held back. Please decide my interim custody application. Please, if you have given the interim custody, if the interim custody is with one parent, let me be provided with access. Let me be provided with contact. Let me be provided with my interaction with the child. The child is going into alienation. Maintenance can be provided. I will provide it. I am volunteering to pay maintenance, provided the court grants me access. So I think there is no bar on the court deciding your application for interim custody, maybe within 1 week, maybe within 1 month. Parties are represented. You move an application for visitation, access, or contact. Serve copy on the other side. Have the co-counsel in court. Take a short date for 1 week. Seek a written response within 1 week and ask the court to take a decision. If interim, no court will decline you access. If it does, take it in revision to the High Court. So I think this inhibition is self-imposed, 60 days, 90 days. There is nothing here in the act. So interim custody can be decided as a matter of priority, and it is up to the court to decide how important it is. So there is no timeline on this. That is the short answer. Next question.
Okay, sir, thank you. The next question is from the Child's Rights Foundation NGO. How can advocates help in bridging the parent-child relationship gap?
Come again? Can you repeat the question?
How can the advocates help in bridging the parent-child relationship gap?
See, the advocates have a big role to play. Now, if the advocate is candid enough to advise his client that joint parenting or shared parenting resolution is the best possible effective way of upbringing a child, that I think is the best response. The child, the advocate is to look upon himself as I would do it as an officer of the court. I have been an amicus in a number of matters. And what you need to do is you need to be very neutral in your approach. You need to be very child friendly. These litigations are not to be viewed in the sense of an adversary litigation. A child is a very innocent and a very vulnerable human being. So in order to avoid any damage to the mind of the child, I think all effort should be made to see how best you can provide contact to the child, access to the child in the best possible way. I have often requested courts, whenever there is an inter-parental child removal, that a co-counsel be present when the visitation takes place so that the lawyer is able to provide a bridge for dissolving hostility between parties. I, as an amicus, have been able to sometimes make grandparents, grandchildren, fighting husband and wife, extended families meet. See, party with time, attitudes harden. With the passage of time sometimes approaches become very, very negative. So a lawyer actually is a very important via media of making opposite sides sit together and work out or hammer a solution. I have seen children holding my hands, sitting with opposite sides, because they are so fearful of the opposite side. So the child says, I am only here because of you. You will not leave my hand. So that is the security which the child wants. And I think the lawyer can be a very good bridge here. You have to give up your role as a lawyer for a party. You have to become the lawyer for the child. This is what I would advocate to my fraternity, to my lawyer brothers and sisters. Become the lawyer for the child. Change your robes. That's the answer, Parth.
Sir, can I add a sentence with your...
Yes, sir. Please, please, sir. Please. Sir, you are the co-host. Please do.
See, what you told is absolutely correct.
Yes, sir.
Theoretically. But practically, yes. See, I'm using the word, many of the cases, if the lawyers are going to the shoes of the litigants.
Yes, sir.
Then things are getting wise ways.
Absolutely.
So, two things I want to add because it's a general discussion. Sir. One, I feel there should be a separate system for dealing the children. Because in the family court, the heaviest contesting as well as the heaviest injustice is happening to the children.
Absolutely.
What you told is that who is representing the child? The state should represent the child. Because that is what in the initially I told. It is a national property. Children are the national property. So, in that such a concept, is very much required when we are handling the child custody issues. Even it is thinking about a jury system itself, in a child custody, it is a more viable, I feel. Just I am putting my thoughts. That's all.
Sir, just to add, I think you have a concept of child rights lawyer or an amicus. I think the court could do well. Since you have a dedicated family court bar, you are probably a very unique jurisdiction in the country, which is privileged to have such an exclusive gathering of like-minded lawyers specializing in that area only. The court could actually draw up a panel of child rights lawyers. You can actually, like you draw up a list of mediators, you can draw up a separate list of child rights lawyers, seek their consent, and appoint young, energetic minds who will be able to devote time, train them, give them support, and the panel should be made available to all family court judges in the family court building. And wherever the judge feels that there is an issue, a child rights lawyer should be appointed. And the last order which Shraddha has shared with me, it describes what duties the lawyer can do, what responsibilities can be performed a child rights lawyer. So this child rights lawyer can be an effective mechanism evolved by procedures. And since under the Family Courts Act, the family court is free to devise its own procedure, the family court is the chief justice of his own court. He can keep a panel, pick up a lawyer, seek a report. And in Perry Consagra's case, the report has to be given to the court and to both sides, and an independent evaluation can be made. I think this is a very fruitful point which comes out in this discussion. And I'm very delighted that this question has been put by the Child Rights Foundation, because it has provided a very meaningful answer and it can be actually put into practice.
Sir, this Child Rights Foundation, last 20 years, I am in touch with them. So many of their advisors as well as their efforts, what you told is exactly correct. It should be a part of the judicial system.
Absolutely.
Unless and until it is coming, these things are what... So this time is too late to take this concept to the judiciary. Actually,
yes.
Law Reformation Committee, I desired to give a representation in this subject.
But sir, since there is a provision under Section 13 for the court to, in the interest of justice, seek assistance, the provision is already there. It is up to the family court judge or the principal judge to create a panel in consultation with a person as empowered and as kind-hearted as your good self. And the family court bar president and the principal judge can, by consensus, draw up a list, seek by public notice requests from whomsoever wish to be appointed. They can appoint a panel of family court lawyers to become independent family court assistants in as family court lawyers or amicus. They can be provided a fee to be shared by both sides, and it can furnish an independent report. And I think it will go a long way. And this family court bar in Bandra, Mumbai, should be a pioneer in this process, in evolving this jurisprudence and laying down an example for the entire country.
Please, let me see and hope for the best.
Please do, sir. Please do. So, Parth, next question, please.
Yes, sir. The next question is also from the Child Rights Foundation NGO. So, it's, does family court have powers to frame rules for setting up a presumption of shared parenting as the children's best?
Of course, you see, under Section 12 and Section 14, the family court is free to devise its own procedure. See, once in substance and in form, there is a petition, there is a pleading, there are issues coined, there is a concrete list before the court. Then it is up to the court, as Section 10, subsection 3 says, that nothing in this subsection shall prevent a family court from laying down its own procedure to arrive at a settlement in respect of any subject matter, or to come to the truth of the facts alleged by one party and denied by the other. And in doing so, the Section 14 says, a family court may receive any evidence, report, statement, documents, information or matter as in its opinion may assist it to deal it effectually dispute whether or not the same will be relevant or admissible under the Indian Evidence Act. Now, you must remember that the Family Courts Act 1984 in the preamble says that it is an act to provide for the speedy, for the establishment of family courts with a view to promote conciliation and secure speedy settlement of disputes relating to marriage and family and affairs and matters connected herewith. So, I think effectively the family court is armed by statute with weaponry in its armor and in its storehouse to use at discretion as best possible, as suited to the facts and circumstances of the case, to find a way out. I think you need an enlightened judge. You need assistance of good counsel like Mr. Nair, who are very meaningful, positive and good vibration and solid energy. The better the assistance to the court, the better empowered the judges, the better the result. So this, I think, is a joint effort. It is a machinery which works in tandem. The vibrations have to go in synchrony. So it is an effort of the bar and the bench which can put the car on track and on rails. The provisions are all there. It's how best you tweak them. And you're allowed to do it. There is no other act in the entire book of statutes which gives so much freedom to the court, sir, to go this way,
sir,
or that.
Can I intervene?
Yes, please, sir, please.
Sir, as Family Courts Act is established under the Special Courts Act.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, of course, it can adopt its own procedure, either CPC or the Evidence Act. These are not strictly applicable.
Yes.
Simultaneously, there is a provision which is contradicting in the Family Court Act itself, telling that for the procedure, CPC is applicable. One aspect.
Yes.
Other aspect, in the Bombay High Court, one or two matters when I represented, I specifically told even Justice Naresh Patel admitted that there is a special trained judges is required in the High Court to deal with the family court matters.
Absolutely.
So now the thing is that if any order is going contradictory, an interlocutory application, a writ is filing in the High Court, and the matter is getting delay, one aspect, and the High Court is going to the technicalities of the aspect that the procedures are not followed.
Absolutely.
This contradiction I feel in that even the Supreme Court one matter I mentioned, they are telling that you adopt your own procedure. I told that, sir, once the procedure is adopted and an order is passed, it is sitting upon in the High Court, and it is again in the discussions and the disputes are coming. So there are specific norms by the Supreme Court itself in the explanation of the statute of the family court. It cannot be go to the legislation. It can be worked out by the Supreme Court. That aspect, you please ask. You are in the Supreme Court. Just see in this point.
I think you're very right. You see, my experience of litigation abroad, because I do a lot of expert reports in foreign courts, and I've traveled to various jurisdictions in international conferences. Now, you look at let me give you an example of Australia. In Australia, you have about 2,000 family courts, and you have a chief justice of the family court of Australia. So they have their own independent kingdom. They have their own rules. They have their own procedures. Everything is separate. In England, you have the family courts, you have courts dealing with these matters, and you have the family division in the High Court of London. So in most jurisdictions, there is a specialist family bar, there are specialist family judges. Now, sadly, in our courts, though the Family Courts Act is there, but in a lot of jurisdictions, still there are no family courts. And where there is no family court, the matter relating to a Guardian and Wards Act petition goes to a guardian judge who is a city civil court judge, who is not bound by the civil courts, who is not bound by the Family Courts Act because he's guided by the CPC. He will not use the powers of a family court because he's not a family court. So there is a contradiction in terms in statute itself. One. Two, we actually speaking, we need a family court judge, or we need a dedicated family court division in the High Court itself. I give you an example. We have in our High Court a lot of petitions relating to runaway couples in our jurisdiction in our High Court. So these runaway couples who are of majority age have consent to marry, come to the High Court seeking protection because they fear vindication from their family. Two benches of our Honorable High Court have ruled recently that granting protection to live-in couples is not going to be permitted because it is approving of a relationship which will destroy the fabric of the society, which is morally and socially not acceptable. Now, there have been two judgments of different benches saying Article 14 and benefit of Article 14 and Article 21 cannot be declined under any circumstances whatsoever, and living in is not living in sin. So you have different views of different benches depending on perceptions of thought of individual judges. So what do we need? We need a dedicated family court bench in courts in the High Court level. We need probably a dedicated bench to deal with family court matters in the Supreme Court as well. We need the Judicial Academy of India in Bhopal to train judges. I often go to Bhopal, and we have a very good Judicial Academy run under Dr. Balram Gupta, very able guidance in Chandigarh also. So we need training of judges. We need judges to be made up to date with family, with matters pertaining to developments in law. A family court judge is perhaps not having the time and energy to go through the updated judgments of law, because if he has 100-150 matters on board, where is his time to read? So we need training. We need specialized judges. We need a dedicated family law judiciary. I'm one with you, sir, on this proposition. So Parth, coming back to your next question.
I'm so sorry. Now, I think we started almost 2 hours. Those, please complete the questions and we will wind
up. No, but sir, Sir,
I'm so sorry, other participants, because I intervene, because the subject is a very
difficult. Your inputs are very important, because you are a leader. You have to lead the bar. You have to be a pioneer. We have to change Mumbai, and Mumbai has to change India. Yes, Parth, please, next question.
Yes, sir, we'll be taking the last two questions now.
Yes, yes.
The first one is from Kumar Reddy. He asked, is there any Supreme Court judgment available to seek a visitation right despite allegations from the murder under POSCO?
You see, there may be, there is no bar on access or custody to a child. Now, I happen to be a witness to a case in the Delhi High Court while I was arguing a matter. A mother was repeatedly trying to avoid contact of the father for visitation purposes of a female child and appearing in person and requesting the court repeatedly that the father is abusing the girl child, and she wanted the matter to be heard in camera. So the court did grant her the liberty, but the court ultimately came to the conclusion that the allegations were unfounded. She went to the Supreme Court. I think she did not succeed even there. So there is nothing to dispel, nothing prevents you to dispel the allegations of the nature of POXO even, or violence or domestic abuse or whatever. And once they are found to be untrue, there is no bar on the court allowing you access or visitation. So a simple allegation of child abuse to thwart an attempt for access, visitation, or contact can be dealt with by legitimately proving and satisfying the court that there is no such intention. It is only a means to keep you away from the child. And once you're able to do so, I don't think there is any reason why you should be prevented from access to the child. So you have to engage effectively to deal with the problem. There is no bar on your access or contact, but you have to get over the allegation to come on a clean slate. Yes, Parth, next question.
Thank you, sir. We'll be having the last question now from Kalpana, who asks that is there, like you mentioned, the independent lawyer counsel is appearing for the child. So the question is, who appoints such an independent counsel or lawyer?
See, the provision is in section 13, subsection proviso. So section 13 talks in the Family Courts Act, says nothing in the court. Now, a lot of you may know that nothing, you family court lawyers are not allowed to appear as a matter of right. So section 13 says, notwithstanding anything contained, a family court shall be entitled as of right to be represented by a legal practitioner, provided that the family court, where it considers necessary in interest of justice, may seek the assistance of a legal expert as an amicus or a family court independent lawyer. So it is the family court which will appoint a family court lawyer or an amicus curiae or an independent lawyer to assist the court. It is the discretion of the court. The appointment of a lawyer to assist the court is always the discretion of the court. It is the necessity of the court. Though, if a counsel for either parties feels the necessity, you can even make an application requesting the court that there is a necessity for a neutral approach, and therefore the court should appoint any person as a amicus or as a court independent lawyer to assist the court.
Thank you, sir.
Parth, if there is still any other question, don't keep yourself back, because these kind of things, questions come in the end when minds are burning and thoughts are evolving.
We can take one more question.
Don't take the questions home. Give them to me.
Yes, we can take one from Himanshu Chaudhrya, who asked that the CWC has given me the visitation rights. while my GW is sub judice, but my wife challenged it in the Honorable Court on jurisdiction grounds, and the Honorable High Court has put stay on my CWC proceedings. So how to convince the High Court that CWC is trying to help child in meeting with father is not wrong, because already there are many judgments against CWC. Please suggest.
You see, the best way to do it is to make an application to the family court or the guardian judge saying, please give me visitation, please give me access, and you rely on the report of the CWC to further your claim and to use it as evidence, best evidence or good support for furthering your claim under the law. You see, CWC, Child Welfare Committee, is a body created administratively with duties and functions under the JJ Act. The Child Welfare Committee is not a court. The Child Welfare Committee is not an authority which is empowered to decide child custody disputes. The Child Welfare Committee is not a judge of what is your right and what is your duty. That is a function attributed to the court. So you cannot take away the function of a court and say that the committee has given it, therefore the court should also do it. The better way of doing it is you pray to the court, you request the court to consider the report of the committee and give you a favorable order, rather than trying to sit on the report of the committee and trying to say the report is final, the court has to obey it. The better way is requesting the court to look at it and pass an independent order in the same lines. So I think the approach should be changed. The attitude should be changed. You should give up your contest in the High Court and seek liberty of the High Court to move the family court to make an appropriate prayer to the family court to pass an independent order. That is the best way to cut short the litigation, rather than waiting for 2 years in the High Court for the High Court to finally decide the matter. Cut short, go back to the family court, ask the family court to take an independent decision. And if the High Court doesn't give you visitation, go back to the High Court again. That's the answer.
Okay, sir. Thank you. With that,
if you still have any other question, don't keep it back. Don't hide it under your bag.
No, sir. That would be all. So, with your permission, if we could move to the vote of thanks now.
Yes, please do.
Thank you, sir. So, I deem it as a great honor to propose a vote of thanks in today's webinar. Firstly, on behalf of the Registrar Sir and Vice Chancellor Sir of MNLU Mumbai, I would like to thank everybody for joining us today. We would like to end the session today by thanking the Family Court Bar Association Mumbai for collaborating with us. Our esteemed chief guest for today, Shri Anil Malhotra Sir, for accepting the invitation to be the chief guest in our session and for sparing his valuable time. Sir, it was indeed a very insightful and informative session, and I'm sure all the participants have benefited from it, including me. I would like to thank Dr. Anand Rao and Dr. Karuna Malviya for helping us understand the topic better and for sparing their valuable time for this session. I would also like to thank our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Dr. Dilip Wikil, and our Registrar Sir, Professor Dr. Anil G. Vairiath, for their support and guidance in carrying out such innovating programs. I would also like to thank the President of the Family Court Bar Association Mumbai, Mr. Sashidharan Nair, for joining us today and sharing his valuable knowledge with us. I would also like to thank Mr. Shraddha Dalvi Ma'am, who is the coordinator on behalf of the FCBA, for coming up with such innovative ideas of the webinar and for collaborating with Maharashtra National Law University, Mumbai. Last but not the least, I would like to thank all the participants for joining us here today in the session and for patiently hearing throughout. With that, I would like to end today's session. And thank you for giving me the opportunity to host this session today.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for listening. I hope everybody.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. All the best, Shraddha.
Thank you, Parth. Thank you, sir.
And Shraddha, I'll be waiting for the video recording of the session.
Yeah, surely I'll share with you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank
yeah,
you,
thank you,
ma'am. So nice of you. Thank you. And thank
yeah,
you
thank
for the opportunity. Grateful. All the best.